Hello and welcome to another edition of A Chat With. I'm your host, Sam Macbeth, and I have got a favorite band that I will be interviewing today. I've had the privilege of interviewing some of Canada's top bands, and this is no exception. These guys have toured with Journey, Tina Turner, Roxette, Corey Hart, Rod Stewart, Cheap Trick, just to name a couple of people you may have heard of. And they were formed in 1983, and they released 5 albums so far, and I'm sure there's more to come. We'll find out during the interview. And they just have it down to an art and entertaining and great music. With me is one of the co-founders of Glass Tiger, Sam Reed. Sam, welcome to the show.
Well, thank you very much. Thank you, Sam.
And like I said, you're one of my favorite bands. I can remember back in the day when I was working the bars. Unfortunately, because I was working the bars as a DJ, I didn't get a chance to see you guys live. But I've always enjoyed your music and that sort of thing. And love what you guys do. And I'm glad that you guys are still around. I love playing your stuff on my radio show. And I want to find out, you guys were formed in 1983. But Glass Tiger wasn't the original name. The original name was Tokyo. What? How did Tokyo come about, and how did it go from Tokyo to Glass Tiger?
Well, it's basically just the early years of a band, juggling members and, you know, cutting your teeth a little bit. And we had a couple of local bands, local to Newmarket, actually, where we grew up. One of the bands was called The End. And one of the bands was called Onyx, and then they imploded. And then from the ashes of those two bands, we formed the band Tokyo. And it was essentially a name that we picked very, very quickly, because we wanted to do some gigs, and we needed something to print on a poster. So we went about our way and were as Tokyo for a few years, and did a lot of showcasing, a lot of club circuit and things like that. And then we were lucky enough to get offered a record deal, and it made us stand back and have a look at the name, because it was a name that we hadn't spent a lot of time and got attached to so much that we felt like, well, this would be the time to, you know, either stick with it or change it. And we decided we wanted to switch it up, and we tossed some names around. We had Paper Tiger was being thrown around, and then Alan, our singer, said, you know, it would be really cool, just change the paper to glass, and it, you know, it'd be kind of a neat way to combo some words, and we fell in love with it that moment, and then we decided to make the change as soon as we started recording albums.
Yeah, and you released your first album in 1986, that was Thin Red Line, and that was an album that exploded on the scene. It went 4 times platinum, had a couple of top 10 hits, Don't Forget Me and Someday. It hit top 10 even in the United States. When you guys did the album, I'm sure you wanted it to be a good album, you were looking for a good album, but is that what you expected, that explosion?
Well, to be honest, we were kids and we had no track record and nothing to basically gauge it on. Some bands, you know, release albums year after year after year, and album number 2 hits, or album number 3 hits, or none of them hit. I mean, that could happen as well. We were lucky. Now, mind you, we had 3 or 4 years of songwriting under our belt before we recorded that album. but we had no impression or no expectations, I guess is the right word, as to what it would or wouldn't do. We just knew that, you know, we had had a really good reaction to some of the songs when we used to perform them live, and we brought those into the studio, and of course we got an opportunity to do some songwriting with a very prominent, famous songwriter in Canada. His name was Jim Vallance, who ended up being the producer on the album. So that didn't hurt either. And that certainly raised our chances at success, because he had so much songwriting success with Bryan Adams that gave this first album, you know, a real push in the right direction. And we were, of course, delighted that it did really well right out of the box.
Yeah, and it not only did well with listeners, it did well in the industry as well, because you guys were nominated for 3 Junos based on the album, and you guys won the 3, including Most Promising Band. How did you guys react to that, knowing that the industry is enjoying your work as much as, and respecting what you're doing as much as the listeners?
Well, certainly, like I said, our expectations were, you know, it was all coming at us as a brand new thing, and we had spent so many years slogging it out in the bar circuit, and of course you always dream of these moments to a large number of people. And when not only the album took off, but when we had the recognition at the Junos, and probably out of all the Junos, the band choice is the one that resonated the most with us, because that was basically us being on the road meeting fans from coast to coast, and that was their reaction, because the fans get to choose that Juno. So that really resonated with us and made us feel very, very happy that you know, that people were enjoying the songs, and it was certainly a confirmation that you know, that the songs had some staying power.
Yeah, and it didn't stop there. You guys released another album in 88, Diamond Sun, which, again, multi-platinum 3 times. And you had another great hit, number 2 in Canada, I'm Still Searching, came off that album as well. And you had some more success with the Junos. So were you guys, would you say at that point you guys had found your footing and you knew who you were and what you were about?
Well, you certainly, you know, Don't Forget Me, when it came out, hit so quickly that, you know, some people in the industry felt that the band came out of nowhere, because, you know, other than the circuit of small, like, clubs we were playing, which would be very under the radar stuff, it did appear to the rest of the country that we came out of nowhere. But we had been doing the slogging out of the bars for 3 or 4 years. And then, of course, delighted with the success of Don't Forget Me, and then repeating the success with Someday. And every time you have a hit song, that's more than one, you know, is great, because the industry, there's a lot of bands who maybe can crack one song in there and have a tough time with the second and whatever. And by the time the second album came out and I'm Still Searching and Diamond Sun got released and did well, you know, it really made us feel great as a band and great as songwriters that we, you know, it's not going to be in that one-hit wonder category anymore, you know, like that so many bands fall into. But, you know, and of course that this opened up greater opportunities for us to tour in Europe and you know, represent Canada and other places of the world and continue. And to this day, we're still doing that based on the strength of those albums.
Yeah, and so basically it took a lot of hard work, a lot of blood, sweat, and tears, and a lot of time for you to become an overnight sensation, basically.
Yeah, I mean, again, we appreciate the fact that it did happen very quickly once it did click. And for a lot of people who had never heard of Tokyo, for instance, you know, and then we changed our name to Glass Tiger, you know, they were like, you know, who are these guys and where did they just appear from? But and for us, it definitely didn't feel like overnight, but the impression was a little bit like that, just because it became a national thing rather than like, you know, there are a couple of small towns in Northern Ontario that we used to have a group of fans, and now we have them coast to coast.
Yeah, and it still didn't stop there. You guys kept working hard, touring, writing music, doing shows, and recording, and you released your third album, which was Simple Mission, which came out in 91, and it again went platinum here in Canada. And for you guys, how was your popularity worldwide? Like, were you popular in most countries?
We had pockets, and this is typical, I think, with a lot of touring bands. They'll have, you know, there used to be another Canadian band called Saga, and Saga are, like, still to this day, like, huge following in Germany, you know. And so, you know, for us, we spent and focused a lot of time in Europe, in places like Scandinavia and Germany, spent a smaller amount of time in England. But that's kind of where the opening tours, when we toured with Tina Turner, she was, you know, the opportunity put us in front of a lot of people with her tour dates. So she was mostly focused in Germany, and we toured again in 91 with Roxette, and that was very much, you know, Sweden, Norway, and that. So that gave us these little pockets of following that otherwise wouldn't have been there, but we didn't get to Australia, even though we had a top 10 single in Australia. And that's probably one of our disappointing aspects of having a hit single and not being able to get to a place, but it just didn't happen. So we never toured in Australia or Japan, but otherwise in Europe, spent a lot of time in Germany and surrounding areas there, and it's been wonderful.
Yeah, and like I said, you you toured with a lot of big names that I mentioned off the top of the interview, and that had to be a tremendous help getting you exposed in these other countries as well, because a lot of Canadian bands, they'd find their success in other countries, and as well as home, of course. And do you feel that was a tremendous help for you guys, or did you kind of build your following on your own?
Well, our manager at the time, my name is Derek Sutton, had some massive success with a band called Styx, of course. And one of the things that he told us, as you know, basically as a game plan, was instead of going over to Europe and becoming, you know, maybe playing a small club for 100, 200, 300 people, his theory was, why don't I see if we can get you on a big tour and you can play in front of 17,000 people, but it won't be your audience, but you can win them over. So our game plan was always, you know, to jump on a tour like Tina. Tina tour was 3 months, and it was multiple cities, multiple dates in each city for, you know, 17,000 plus. And I think that was a good move for exposure. And it would have been taking us a lot longer at 200 or 300 people in a small club over the years to build an audience in those countries. But so that was the game plan anyway.
Now, after that album came out, when you got to 1993, you guys took an extended hiatus from performing and that sort of thing. What did you guys do over that? Like, what did you do over that time? Did you write songs, work with another band, do some solo stuff?
Yeah, by the time, we hadn't taken a break since 1984, essentially. And at the end of the Simple Mission album, we toured a bit, and sort of coming to the end of 92 into early 93, we were a little road tired. And we just mutually agreed that we would take a little bit of time off, you know, not dissolve the band, but just take some time. Alan, the singer, said, you know, I wouldn't mind maybe putting a couple of solo things out, you know. And the funny thing is, Alan and I ended up doing a lot of writing for his solo album. So I went from writing Glass Tiger songs to writing songs with Alan Crewe for his solo stuff. So songwriting wise, you know, there's obviously a common thread through that, and that kept me busy working on his solo albums. And then I also ventured off into producing a few other young bands and spending more time in the studio. And to be honest, the hiatus was supposed to be a year, maybe two at tops, and you get busy, and then it snuck up on us, and we realized, holy, you know, it's been like more like 5 or 6 years before we got back together, and that was never the intention, but that's just the way it played out.
Yeah, and that hiatus had to be a help to you guys as a band as well, because you were one of those, from what the research that I've done with different bands and that I've interviewed, you guys have pretty much stayed intact. You've changed one member since the beginning. Did that hiatus help you guys to keep the bond together?
Well, we're a very close band. I always have been, and to this day. And one of the things that's that's important for us is that everybody is enjoying it, and it's really critical that everybody's heart is in that. We had heard horror stories of other bands that, you know, were on the road longer than they wanted to be because they had, you know, either a commitment to it or a management that kept them going or whatever. We had this sort of agreement that, and that's the reason we took the break. Like, whenever we decide as a band that we want a break, we take a break. And, you know, earlier it wouldn't have been good to take the break. Our management said, you know, you've got some decent momentum coming off these albums. This would be a really bad time to take a year off or whatever. But there will be another time in your future if you guys want to do that. And that's what we did. So it's always been something that we discuss democratically kind of in the band. And it's important that everyone is in 100% or we don't do it.
Yeah. And does everybody in the band contribute songwriting wise?
Yes, certainly the core members, like you've got Al Conley, myself, and Alan Frew, since day one, you know, that's pretty much the core writing team in the band, and to this day, again, we've always done that, and then we've had some outside writers like Jim Balance and a few other writers that have, you know, some ideas have been co-written, which is kind of nice for variety. It kind of keeps things fresh, but yeah, there's definitely... the three of us are the core writing team and always have been.
Yeah, and while we're talking about that, the songs themselves, what do you think is the key to them resonating so well even today?
Well, if you could bottle that as a magic formula, everybody would want it. Every band in the world would want it. You first and foremost, you write songs for yourself because something makes you feel like writing them, so takes you in a direction, whether it be Thin Red Line or something really light like Don't Forget Me. You know, those are just reactions to the world we live in, and then you go out there and you do that for yourselves and you believe in that, and then it's just like the awesome thing is when somebody approaches you and says, you know, I love this song, Someday, how did you know what I was thinking? Well, of course, as a songwriter, that's the best compliment you can ever be paid. When somebody not connected to the song feels like the lyric or the melody or something, some aspect of the song has resonated with them in their lives, and then it becomes this little mini timestamp. So people, to this day, people will come up and say, you know, when I hear that song, I'm transported right back to the day when I was in high school or I was, you know, this part of my life. And I think that's a measure of a song that has some staying power, and you know, and we're song listeners as well. Like, I mean, we're huge, Beatles fans and you know, other bands. And when we listen to them, you know, it affects us the same way. So we've just been really fortunate that the Glass Tiger songs have had that staying power. I think the elements in the song are, you know, if you're lucky enough. They sort of become timeless, and we're delighted that we're still in gold rotation you know, on a lot of the radio stations that play 80s, 90s, you know, throughout the decades, and it'll be in there somewhere. So that's pretty cool.
Well, it's bands like you, Saga, as you mentioned, Honeymoon Suite, just to name a few of the bands, the Headpins, and just those bands for me were the bands I grew up with, like you said, in high school and my young adulthood. And those songs resonate with me to this day. Like I said, you are one of my favorite bands, along with Saga, coincidentally. And I love the fact that now I'm playing. I'm the morning man, not only at this station KPHR, but I'm also been picked up by a station in Norfolk, Virginia. So I get an opportunity to bring your songs to those people in the college towns. And I'm getting a lot of positive feedback on the Canadian music that I'm playing. And I'm not doing the CanCon thing. I play the Canadian music because I want to play the Canadian music. What do you think is the key to to Canadian music being as good as it is, including coming up on today with today's artists?
Well, Canada has always been so well represented. If you were to take the proportion of the population versus, you know, a huge, huge population like in the U.S., and you were to, you know, look through the list of artists that have, you know, and actors really, that have resonated in other countries, especially in the U.S., you know, Canada should be pretty proud of how much content, you know, comes from Canada in all aspects. And those songs, I think, you know, a lot of bands are like I said, if you're lucky enough to get down there. When we were down in the U.S. and spent a lot of time touring with Journey, and then we got the nomination for the Grammy, and we were sitting in the room with all those, you know, international artists. It's pretty cool feeling to know, like, you know, you're representing Canada there, and you look around the room and you've got, you know, so many artists like, you know, Bublé and Celine Dion. I mean, these are mega, mega artists that the world knows. And it's just great to be on a list of bands that have cracked into the U.S. and been able to, you know, to build a fan base down there. And it's something that right now, it's just sometimes difficult to tour everywhere and in the market and that. And we have so many fans from places like the U.S. that keep asking us, you know, when are we coming back to Atlanta? When are we coming back to, you know, Houston, places like that? And of course, if we had it our way, we would, you know, we would keep doing tours and some appearances here and there. And we love to get to some of these other places around the world.
Yeah, and you're doing very well, and you're touring and enjoying what you're doing and having a good time. And then the pandemic hits. How did that affect you guys as a band? Obviously, you weren't able to do shows. So how did you guys spend the time with the pandemic?
Well, of course, you know, the entertainment business, music specifically, first business to shut down in the pandemic and the last business to start up, because, you know, and rightfully so, it's not necessarily an essential business for, you know, if you're in healthcare or something like that, of course, that's a, you know, up the priority list. But for us, it was still, you know, we had a string of U.S. dates coming. We of course had our normal touring in Canada, and everything grinds to a complete halt. And disbelief sets in, because you think, oh, maybe it'll be a week or two, and then a month or two, and then 6 months, and then a year, and then you realize, you know, that obviously, like the rest of the world, this is going to last a bit longer. So for us, what we decided to do once the touring was shut down, we took upon ourselves to solve a problem that we had many years ago. We were always asked if we could do a Christmas holiday album. Well, we never figured out how to do it. We were never happy with the cover songs, and we hadn't written anything that we were thrilled about either. So we decided that we would use our COVID downtime to take a fresh look at that. And that's what we did in our downtime. We'll probably never ever do another holiday album, but at least we got one, and we're really happy that 99% of it is all original material. And we recorded it. We had some lovely guests on the album. And that's now, when we look back at our downtime, that's what we have to show for it.
That's fantastic. Now, we're back to getting back on the road and everything, touring and that sort of thing. And if the fans go to your website, glasstiger.ca, there's a lot of great stuff on there. And you've got a few dates starting to come up, starting this summer, where you're going to be doing Rock the District in Edmonton. You're going to be down in New Brunswick in July, and up in North Bay coming up in August. Are there more dates that are going to be coming out in the near future?
They are just finalizing a lot of the summer festivals, so I have a feeling there might be a few more plugged into our schedule. We are hoping to do something in the fall, which we're working on now. It'd be the fall or early part of the year, where we might join a couple of other bands and maybe put something on the road if we can. But certainly the summertime is full of festivals. It's great, and there's so many of them across Canada, East Coast, West Coast, in the prairies. So we find ourselves zigzagging back and forth quite a bit in the summer months, and hopefully they'll add a few more to our schedule. But it's a fun looking summer right now, that we pretty much get to go coast to coast again, which is always a treat.
Yeah, and just before I let you go, have you got any new projects that are going to be coming down the road, some new music?
We always work on new music, so there's never a time where we're not chipping away at ideas. We actually have a fair number of new song ideas that are in various stages of completion, but not far off. So we just haven't figured out how we want to stitch them together. But I think you'll find that, because we are songwriters and we just, love to do that, we'll always be writing new stuff. We'll probably put out, we might finish one or two of them and put them out as sort of like a digital single, even that, just so the fans have something new and to listen to, and that keeps us motivated as well. So I would expect to see something over the summer, towards the fall, that we will probably finish up and release out there. That's a game plan anyway.
And with that in mind, I want to thank you for taking some time for me. I am honored to have had a chance to meet you and talk with you. And I'm looking forward to some of the new material coming down the pike in the summer. And hopefully your guys will get it to me and I can play it for our listeners. But in the meantime, I want to wish you all the best. I want to thank you very much for taking some time. And I wish you good luck with the tour. The name of the town that we need you to come to is Hamilton. We have a nice little festival here in the summer. I believe you played it once or twice. Festival of Friends.
For sure. And our drummer's from Hamilton. There you go.
Oh, well, there you go. Well, tell them Sir John A. MacDonald students say hello.
All right.
You take care. Be good. And again, thank you very, very much. And is there anything you want to say before you go for our fans?
Well, listen, thank you very much for continuing to listen to Glass Tiger Music, and thanks, Sam, for getting it getting it out there, even with your syndicated stuff in different places. That's always great. So I really appreciate that effort, and we look forward to seeing people in a live capacity. That's always fun, and definitely find us online, and that's the most updated information is on the website, and we hope to see everyone soon.
And with that, this has been a chat with Sam Reed, co-founder of Glass Tiger. I'm Sam Macbeth, and I want to thank you guys for listening. And to take us home, this is Someday. Talk to you again real soon. Take care. Be good. Love you all. Bye-bye.
street.